Alrighty, Tuesday! Time to go to work. So I'm Hamish Tristram and I'm the aquarist at the science place at JCU. And I'm going to take you for a little bit of my day and what I do during the day. So it starts with a coffee, just had my coffee. But I'm going to walk down to my scooter now and I'm going to scoot to work. So come with me. Righto, here we go. Down the stairs. And what I'm going to do today is just show you what my day entails, because I get to work with so many different animals and do so many different things. And so I thought if I took you with me right from the very start of my day, you'll get a bit of a taste of what an aquarist does. As you can see, this is the vehicle of choice for aquarists, my beautiful scooter. Let's get this thing going. I'm going to head to work and I'd like you to ride along with me. Actually got to harvest our little baby brine shrimp. So if you look behind me, I'll try and get a view there, that bubbling little soup you can see. That's actually tiny little brine shrimp that have hatched over a 24-hour period. And I'm actually going to get those little brine shrimp out and feed them to our corals and some of our fish that we've got on display. So one of the tasks in the morning is to actually harvest these brine shrimp. So bear with me and I'll show you some of the process. If you look behind me, you can see here these brine shrimp are actually now heading into the bucket. And inside the bucket I have this fancy thing here, which is a magnet. So what happens is these brine shrimp actually have, or the eggs have, they're magnetized, so they basically have a metal capsule around the outside of the shell. So what happens is when we harvest them, all those empty shells or cysts will attract to the magnet and separate the good viable part of the brine shrimp from the actual casing that surrounds them. So it means that once we've harvested them and separated those shells, what's left we can feed to our fish. So I'll show you the next phase in a second. So what I've done now is I've actually put all these brine shrimp inside this bucket with our magnet, and look what happens when I pull the magnet out. Ta-ta! So you can see there all those basically the old shells that have come off the hatched brine shrimp. They've attached themselves to the magnet because they do have those metal fragments in them. I'm going to hose those off the magnet. I'm going to place the magnet back in the bucket. And I'm going to keep doing that until basically all those old shells have come away from the good brine shrimp. And then we'll feed those brine shrimp out to our corals. They're usually pretty hungry on a Monday, so they'll look forward to their breakfast. And what I'm doing now, if you follow me around, back to the cone that we've got here, you can see I put some more air in it. And what I'm going to do now, I'm going to grab these. Not really. I'm going to place them into the cone. About a couple of shakes, very scientific as to the amount I put in. And what happens now, over the next 24 hours, those little eggs are going to hatch, like sea monkeys that you get from the aquarium shops that kids often buy. And I'm going to put some lights above them to give them some heat. And then the whole process will start again tomorrow. So we actually hatch these brine shrimp out every single day in a 24-hour period, or a 24-hour interval, and then feed them out to our marine tank and some of our corals that we have in quarantine. So first job of my day is generally taking care of these brine shrimp and feeding them out. So I'll continue to separate those shells with that magnet that I showed you before, and then we'll take them across to the aquarium and I'll show you how we feed them out. Stand by. Now, here's the fun part. here's where we get to feed the display tank and the corals, that bronchant that I prepared earlier on. You know what, I'm really lucky because I've got a lot of offices here at JCU that I get to go into, and it is the best job in the world because I get to work with all these different animals, and I'm going to introduce them to you today as my day goes on. But I'm going to open a store here, and you'll see what I mean by a pretty good office. Look at this. Ho 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 ho. So, here we are on the top of the aquarium. So it's like being transcended back to the Barrier Reef every day. Beautiful clear blue water, lovely corals, and all these fish waiting for me to come and feed them. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to grab some of that brine shrimp and I'm going to place it in here, and these corals are going to start to eat it. So if we go back this way, I'm being very coordinated today, actually holding the camera and doing this. And for people that know me, coordination is not really one of my strengths. So I'm going to dip this beaker into our brine shrimp. And then I'm going to feed these hungry mouths that are beneath me. So the main animals that will eat this brine shrimp are actually the corals. So corals are actually colonies of lots and lots and lots of different individual animals, and they actually have mouths that will eat these live brine shrimp. So not only do they make food from light, but they also eat food in the water. And these tiny little brine shrimp are one of the best foods for our corals, and that's how we keep our corals going here in the science place. So watch me as I actually place the brine shrimp in. And you know what's really interesting is if you come back to the aquarium after an hour or so after those brine shrimp have been placed in, you'll notice a lot of the polyps will come out and you can actually see them actively eating. So you know what, I reckon I'm their favourite person to see on a Monday morning because I come bearing gifts and they're usually hungry after a weekend and they will gobble up that brine shrimp. So first task of the day, brine shrimp. And if I do that, well, the corals will always be happy with me. Now, look, another thing I do in the mornings, I've got these highly trained fish in the freshwater tank. You watch what I'll do. Look behind me. Look at all these beautiful, beautiful, beautiful little rainbow fish that are in our freshwater tank display up here in the science place. So I've got some hardy heads, I've got some rainbow fish, I've got some Pacific blue eyes, but the best thing is I've trained them. Watch this. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Ah, here they are, look. Ah, look, following me. Righto. Okay. Let's see if we can get them back the other way. Come on. Rainbow fish. What they're doing, they're following me for food because they see my uniform. And they realise that I give them food, particularly when I've got a bucket sitting there. They kind of suspect that I've got food. So you know that you've heard that fish have got a 5-second memory, that they can do a lap of the tank and actually forget what they've done. That's not true. In fact, if you feed fish at a certain time, every day or every second day, those fish will quickly learn that you give them food. And every time I walk past this tank, those fish are there waiting for some food. So they're actually pretty intelligent. Well, compared to me, they probably are, but I get on well with fish for that reason. They love their food and their memory is pretty good. So what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna go grab some food and feed these guys, and you can watch how much they love their food. So bear with me. Alrighty, now I hope you're not scared of heights. Because I'm up a ladder here at the top of the freshwater tank. What I'm gonna do now is place some of this food in. So I've got some flake here. And I'm going to put some water in there and feed our freshwater fish. And I'm going to show you how much they love their food. But Mondays are pretty busy for me because after the weekend, of course, a lot of the animals need feeding. A lot of the tanks need water changes and cleans. So there's a lot to do. All the way from, you know, sometimes I've got to clean the main tank there, get in and dive and clean that. And also in this freshwater tank here, I've got to do water changes. So I do a big water change and a clean every Monday. And importantly, I give the fish some food. So I'm going to place this in the water. And in the food goes. I'm going to climb down the ladder and hopefully do it in an OH and S safe way. So I'm holding onto the railing, as you can see, and I'm walking backwards. And I'm focusing on the ladder. Exemplary technique. And now, looking behind me, can you see these beautiful fish eating their food? So these guys are amazing because they love their food, but they don't really get aggressive towards each other. The rainbow fish, they're very gregarious, they get on well, and even when you put food in, they don't argue over it, they all share it. And they'll feed, I'll give these guys food pretty much every day, and they'll get a fair bit bigger than this. You can notice some of the smaller ones, they're probably about 2 centimeters long, if that. They will get up to about, anywhere up to 10 centimetres. Some of the bigger rainbow fish, up to 12 centimetres. So in time, they will get quite a bit bigger. But they are very peaceful. So even when they get quite large, they don't fight with each other, which is fantastic. So this is a freshwater tank. If I pan back a little bit, you can see it's quite big. It's about 3.6 metres long and holds about 1,500 litres of fresh water. And it's on the first floor in the science place. So come up and have a look at it, because I've been developing this over some time. In the years gone by, it had a couple of Baku grunter and had some different fish in it. But these days we're going to try and put some planted material in there. You can see those lovely plants and lots of native freshwater fish. So come and watch the work in progress, and hopefully you like what you see. Alrighty, that's them done for now. Let's move to the next task. Now, one of the greatest things about working in the science place is having contact not only with animals, but lovely, lovely work colleagues. And one of my favourite is Janice, and I've got to put her on now. So here she is, working hard. And you know what? It's always hard to find Janice.
Hi, everyone.
Because she's always working so hard, and she's hard to find because she's scrubbing away somewhere or cleaning something up or taking care of something or organising something. So she's an absolute workhorse and a real pleasure to work with. And it's been lovely to meet and know Janice. So I had to take the opportunity to put her in the frame as I go past.
Thank you, Hamish.
One of the wonderful things about this job too is like the diversity of animals I get to work with, and I love it, as well as beautiful people like Janice. But look in here, see if we can show you this little freshwater turtle. It's actually a saw-shelled turtle. And I'm gonna grab it out. Oops, up you come. Here we go. Let's try and get that in focus. My little mate here. So this is a little saw-shell turtle. You notice why I'm holding it? I'm actually holding him under the shell here with my fingers just in between the shell and the base of the leg there. And that's actually the best way to hold these guys, because a lot of people try and pick them up around the middle of the shell, and they're really strong and they can kick and they can actually get out of your grip, and unfortunately they can fall to the ground and do some damage. So you're better off holding them on the back of the shell like that, nice and tight. So even if they kick those back legs and those front legs, they can't get any purchase on your hand and actually get out of your grip. So this guy here, you can see, and get him up nice and close. He's a gorgeous little animal. Native freshwater turtle. What's the difference between a turtle and a tortoise? Well, a lot of people do know and some people don't. The best way is that the turtles actually have these flat swimming like feet, web feet, that they can swim in the water, and they predominantly spend most of their time in the water. They'll come out to lay their eggs on the land or bask in the sun, but they're really most of the time in the water environment, whereas the tortoises, they have club-like feet and they're terrestrial land dwellers. So whilst they're obviously quite closely related, the turtles are quite different to the tortoises in terms of their lifestyle and their physical traits or physiology. These saw-shell turtles, they're quite a common freshwater species in Australia. Actually, we're pretty lucky up here in North Queensland because we've got a variety of different freshwater turtles. And the ones that you see a lot of the time in the local rivers and around the parklands, they're the crest turtles. We also get what's called the Rankin, which is a northern long-necked turtle, and a few different species. But aren't they amazing? You can see if I turn it over, that shell there, that protective shell, it's a pretty good adaptation, so that of course it protects the animal and makes sure that it's pretty safe from any potential predators. And these guys, they'll feed on pretty much anything that they can eat underwater, so little crustacea, little fish and things like that. You know what an interesting fact is too? They can't actually swallow their food above land. So they'll often come up and they'll grab food on the land, but they'll always take it back into the water to eat, because they rely upon that pressure on their diaphragm to actually swallow that food. So you'll never see one of these little turtles actually consuming food on the land. They'll take it, but they'll always take it back underwater and actually swallow it underwater. But you could talk about turtles all day, and he's a gorgeous little one. I'd always love to see him on a Monday. And what I'm gonna do is do a water change on this tank, make sure it's nice and clean, and then I'm gonna put some food in for him. And basically we'll do that. So this guy's living in this tank at the moment, and hopefully down the track we can find somewhere to display him. The other thing about these turtles is they're very long lived. He can live 50 or 60 years. So they live a long, long time. You hear lots of times of people giving their family members pet turtles, and they end up becoming like a family heirloom, because if they're actually looked after properly, they end up getting passed on to future generations because they can live so long. So don't buy a turtle on impulse. Always remember, sometimes it's more than a lifelong commitment. So they're pretty cool animals. See, now I am siphoning this tank out, and you can see all the matter that comes out. It actually gets quite dirty. I love turtles to bits. They do have the potential to be quite messy, probably a bit like me actually, so they need lots of cleaning. And I'm going to actually siphon this tank out, probably about a 20% water change, and then I'm going to top that water back up. So you can see there, just by siphoning that out into the bucket, getting a lot of that waste material out. And a lot of keeping animals is actually making sure that you keep them clean, because a lot of the issues happen with health is when the hygiene levels go down, and that's a big part of it. So I'm going to siphon that out, and then I'm just going to pick that hose up. I've got all those waste materials out of that tank, and I'm going to place some food in. So what do turtles eat? Like I said before, they'll eat small crustaceans, and they'll eat bits of pretty much anything really, but they love fish, and they love small prawns and things like that. But in captivity here, we've got these turtle pellets, which are a pretty complete food item actually. So I'm going to place those in the tank, and like I was saying before, I actually do place them on the land, and every morning those pellets will be gone. They come up, or he comes up and actually takes those pellets, takes them into the water and eats them. So he does like those. But what I'll do every now and then is I'll throw some bits of dead fish in there. Sometimes I throw some crickets in. Like all of us, there likes a bit of variety in his diet. So that's really important. Look, before I go too, you might say, why do you call the animals he all the time? Why is it a he? It might be a she. It is in fact a male. And the way we can tell turtles, it's a bit hard to see now because his tail's tucked up underneath. But male turtles actually have long, male turtles have long tails because the reproductive organs are actually housed at the base of that tail. So as a result, their tail is proportionally longer than females. And also with males, they have a different shell shape. So they're actually concave underneath, whereas the females are quite round underneath. So the two ways to tell the gender of a turtle really are the length of the tail and the shell shape. So that's why I am calling this one a he, because it's a boy. There you go, another bit of trivia for the day. Okay, so the favorite part of my job is of course, without doubt, looking after the animals. And I'm gonna show you some more of those through the day. But you might notice behind me, I've got these little test tubes here. And what I'm actually doing is a very important part of looking after the aquarium is actually the water quality. So a lot of people say when you keep aquariums and fish, and corals, you're actually not looking after the animals, you're looking after the water. Because if your water quality is good, your animals will be healthy. So a big part of what I've got to do during the week is this. So in the laboratory, I go and I grab some water out of the aquarium, and I put the various reagents with the salt water. So here today, I'm testing for ammonia levels, I'm testing for phosphates, nitrate, things like that. So what happens is when I've got the reagent in the tube, I actually place them in this machine, which is a pretty fancy looking machine. So it's the Palin test. And what happens there, I actually insert these tubes into this machine, and it will give me a reading of the various elements that I'm looking for, or the various sort of water parameters I'm looking for. So I'm looking for those very typical things like ammonia and nitrite, that if they build up too much, they're detrimental to the fish and to the corals. So what I do is I do the water testing, and once I've done that, I check the pH, I check the salinity, and I record all of these results. Here's one I prepared earlier on this sheet here. And so what happens then, because the results are all recorded, we can look through at any given time and see trends in the water quality. So if it's been going down or up, and try and work out why those trends are happening. So a big part of the job is actually water quality. And that's one of the first things I do in the day, as well as the brine shrimp. Now, I don't like to play favorites, but I kind of struggle not to sometimes, because how could you not have Pedro, our beautiful carpet python, as one of your favorites? Look at that, gorgeous. So he's a bit of a friend of mine, so I'm just gonna introduce you to him, because I kind of feel like a morning cuddle, and it looks like he's ready for one as well. So watch this space. Hello, hello. Here I am, walking outside, scaring people. No, that's good. So I'm gonna take my friend out for a little bit of sun. You know what, he's a really good friend of mine, because I can sit outside and have a bit of a chat. Always listens, never judgmental. In fact, I don't think he can really hear me. As you know, snakes don't have external ear holes, so they can't really hear what I'm saying. Probably lucky for him, really. But if you don't like snakes, come and meet Pedro. Because Pedro is the most beautiful carpet python that you'll ever come across. I get my morning kiss. And he's one of my favorite animals here at JCU, the Science Place. And I reckon he's fast becoming one of the most well-known inhabitants of the Science Place. And now it's funny, when I'm cleaning the cage and people will come past me, they'll be able to tell me exactly where he was the day before and what he was doing. And people love Pedro. He's a gentle giant, and he has never bitten anyone. You'll notice that tongue comes in and out, and basically he's just trying to have a bit of a smell. He uses that tongue as a sensory organ. Those beautiful colors, it actually makes him blend into the environment that he's from. So this is actually a jungle carpet python. And in the wild, they're generally found up around sort of the Atherton area, up around Mission Beach, even those areas, to the west of Cairns. And that beautiful colour you can see is actually quite good at blending him in to that environment, so that predators can't see him. To be honest with you though, at this size, there's not many predators that will possibly cause an issue for Pedro, because when you're this big, you're actually pretty safe. But like I was saying before, he's one of my favorite animals. He's absolutely beautiful. And look, snakes are often misjudged. And I tell people that if you're a little bit worried about snakes, get to know an animal like this. It's a really good way to educate yourself, so that you might not be as scared if you come across one. And they're an important part of our environment. We need snakes because they're a part of a natural ecosystem. They're actually one of those animals that is an apex predator, so it plays a really important role in maintaining a healthy ecosystem. And they really don't want anything to do with humans. So if you do come across one, just give it the option to go the other way, and always will. And ones like these carpet pythons, of course, they have no venom. They're a constrictor, so they're completely harmless. I often say to people, if you find one in your roof or in your yard, it's doing you a huge favor, because it's actually eating all your rats and your mice and any animals like that, pigeons maybe, that might be roosting up on your roof. So it's doing you a huge favor, and it doesn't ask for anything in return. So be kind to snakes, please. They're fantastic. And if you want to meet a really nice friendly one that perhaps you can have a pat of or get up close to, ask about Pedro. He's the resident carpet python in the Science Place at JCU. And you'll often see me out in the lawn or walking around with him. He's a really good friend of mine, and I'm quite protective of Pedro, so I'm like a proud dad. Bye. Kiss for the camera. There you go. If I can find the camera. Okie dokie, so I've just cleaned out Pedro's water, you can see here. Thought I'd just give you a little bit of a look inside his enclosure. And this is one of the favourite spots for Pedro to sit. And the reason being is up above the roof there, there's a nice big heat lamp there. So he can sit under the heat and also get some nice UV as well. So if you do come past the enclosures, a lot of people come past, they look at the bottom there and think, oh, that enclosure's empty. But if you just raise your eyes up, 9 times out of 10, you'll see Pedro sitting up there at the top and soaking up that UV and a little bit of heat. So that's where you'll certainly find him. But it's a lovely big enclosure here. There's lots of limbs for him to climb on. And he's quite happy here. When he's thirsty, he'll simply come down to the floor here and have a drink of fresh water. So there you go. Welcome to Pedro's home. No, Pedro. Remember what I was saying before? He's probably fast asleep now. That tongue's not going in and out. And even though his eye's open, he can't actually shut that eye. So, no, Pedro. Now, I have someone else to introduce to you. We're on the theme of reptiles this morning. And this is one of our beautiful, beautiful blue tongue lizards. You can see, not overly COVID safe. Gives me a bit of a kiss in the morning. And very, very friendly animal. In fact, who doesn't know about blue tongue lizards in Australia? They're one of the most iconic lizards and one of the largest skinks. That's right, it's actually a skink. So, you know those little skinks that you find on your fence in your backyard? They're actually related to this beautiful big blue tongue. Now, we keep a few here in the science place, but we don't keep them on display. You actually keep them out the back. And the reason we do that is because we use them for interp. So when people need to get up close to an animal or a reptile particularly, whether it be in a class or whether there be an orientation week or a student experience, these blue tongue lizards are fantastic to get out where people can safely pat one, look at one, ask questions. And they're really good resource at the science place to use for that. And I have a real soft spot for blue tongue lizards. I find them just to be such beautiful, gentle, amazing lizards. And like I say, they're just a part of the Australian culture. Who hasn't had a blue tongue lizard at some point that they know of in their backyard, or a friend might have kept one as a pet? Now look, here out the back, part of my job too. I could talk all day, but I should show you what I actually do. You can see this large enclosure here is actually where we keep some of these blue tongue lizards. And what I do now, I'm actually going to get the water bowls out, change the water. One of the cornerstones of looking after animals successfully is making sure that they have clean water available at all times. Make sure they've got some food, which at the moment I've got these, you can see these pellets here, which are a blue tongue mix. But these guys are pretty spoiled. They also get, they get grapes, they get fruit of different types, banana. Every now and then they get some mealworms or some crickets. So we mix it up a little bit. But what I do in the morning is just check they're okay, have a bit of a look, have a bit of a smooch. And then I make sure they've got clean, fresh water and fresh food. So that's what I'm gonna do now. And keep our beautiful blue tongues nice and happy. I know, lucky to be able to have time with such beautiful animals, and I never ever take it for granted. To come to work and work with animals like this is something that I'm very privileged to do, and I'm always grateful for that. And it's a wonderful part of the job that I can help look after animals like this. Okay, so what I'm doing now, look at my bucket. I've actually got some strange ice cubes in there, and I'm walking up the stairs to the top of the aquarium because I'm going to feed the aquarium. So what's in those ice cube trays is actually a mixture of minced up prawns, bits of basically spinach, continental parsley, greens, radicchio, things like that. Because a lot of the fish in this tank are actually herbivores. So I'm actually going to put those minced up plants and prawns. And what we do, we mince them up, we put them in these ice block trays, and they actually freeze into these cubes. And what I'm going to do now is actually place those cubes inside these containers that have holes in them, and the fish can actually come and eat the food out of those containers. And it's quite spectacular to see, because all the fish can come in, and by having them in those small containers with those holes, it means the large fish can't eat all the food before the smaller ones can get to it. So I'm going to place these frozen blocks of food in those containers. I'm going to place some frozen mice, some brine shrimp, in the tank as well. And lucky fish, I'm going to place some fresh nori. Those of you that like sushi, I love sushi. Our fish are no exception. I'm going to place some nori sheets in as well. So I'm going to show you how I put those in the tank, and then I'm going to take you downstairs to see them eating that food. So it's a pretty good sight. Bear with me. So here, I'm actually on top of the tank, as you can see. These are the lights that we have for the corals. And you can see the overflow there in the center underneath my feet. And that's the other side over there. And the fish are getting quite excited. You can see when I put the phone over there, the fish are actually getting quite excited because they know some food's coming. Now these are the containers I was talking about. You can see it's got a weight on one end that allows it to go down to the bottom. And I'm going to place the food inside these containers, and the fish can actually pick at the food through these holes. And as the food dissolves, you'll notice that it'll actually start to come out of those holes. So I'm going to put this food into these containers and lower them in the tank, and then we can go and have a look at them having their morning tea. So let's see how it goes. So here's the food all ready to go. I've got the nori and some of the brine shrimp in there. And here we've got the cubes and some of the brine shrimp and the mices. So, in they go. You can see the weight there. We'll actually sink that down to the bottom, and also the other one. And let's go down and have a look from the other side. Okay, so here we've got the results. If you look behind me, you can see these fish really enjoying that food that's in those containers. So like I was saying before, you've actually got the larger fish can't eat all the food straight at once, because see those small holes there? You can see those great big rabbit fish, and there's our orange banded surgeon fish. They're actually putting their mouth through those small holes trying to get some of that food, but they can't get it all in one go. Now that's really good, because it means that the smaller fish can actually come in and get their share as well. So can you see behind me, we've got those little blue chromis, and we've got other small fish there. They're all coming in too and getting their share. As that food actually disperses through the water, they can all get their share. So it works really, really well. And you can see if you go higher and lower down, there's some food up the top there as well, and they can actually get that. And what happens too, and I will turn the camera around in a second, have a look at some of the corals, because as that food actually starts to drift through the tank, the coral polyps will start to open up, and the corals change quite a bit as they start to absorb some of that food. So if you look behind me now, it's just like the lunchroom, isn't it, really? You see everyone getting their tea and their scones and their coffee and having a chat about what their day's going to bring and what they're up to on the weekend. And it's no different than the fish tank. In fact, they're all interacting there, sharing the food. Quite social creatures, really. And you can see there's no animosity or aggression between them. They're all happy to share the food. The majority of fish in this tank are actually herbivores, which means that they actually feed upon vegetation such as algae and things like that. And they're really good to have in a tank, because what happens is if you have too much algae, it grows over all the corals. And the trouble with that is that those corals then can't get the sufficient amount of light they need, and they don't do very well. So those herbivores, things like the blue tangs, the rabbit fish, they actually eat that algae and they stop it growing over the coral. So what we do here in the aquarium, the display aquarium, is by putting lots of these herbivores in, we're actually replicating what happens in the reef. And that's how the reef actually reduces that algae level over those corals, by using herbivorous animals to keep control of it. So we're not reinventing the wheel, we're just doing, or they're doing what they're meant to do. And we're just harnessing that here in captivity. So it's a really good way to set a tank up, is to think about an ecosystem and to think about the role that all the different animals play. And if you can do that, you've got more chance of succeeding because you will reach a natural balance within that aquarium. So if you look behind me now, I'm just going to scan around a little bit. You see those beautiful corals? I don't know if you can see them. I'll try and get in a bit closer. I'll lean up against here. Behind me now, those orange corals, they're actually what we call tabastia. Sometimes it's known as sunshine coral. And you'll notice they become like little flowers, because what happens is that food goes through the water, those little polyps will come out, those little tentacles, and they'll grab some of that food. And they change quite a bit. So they go from being quite retracted to actually looking like a flower. That's why sometimes they're called daisy corals, because once those polyps come out, they actually do almost look like a beautiful orange daisy. So there you have it. Look at that. Isn't that great? You can watch them eating there. And you know what? Sometimes I wonder if these guys are actually crossbred with piranhas, because you put the food in and it's gone within about 5 minutes. And I think, how on earth do they get through it so fast? But they love their food and they certainly don't do much mindful eating. It's all in, one for all. They eat it as fast as they can, and before you know it, it's gone. Now here, I've also got, out the back in the quarantine area, a number of tanks that are used for quarantine. So basically, if we get animals in, we like to put them in a separate tank before we mix them with the display tank. And also we do keep animals here that we might want to use for certain classroom learning experiences and things like that. So at any given time, there's a variety of different animals that we do keep out the back here. And they range from corals to crustaceans to various types of starfish and things like that. But what I have to do is I have to feed these guys as well. So in this bucket, I've actually got some frozen brine shrimp that I've defrosted. And basically now, I'm going to go around and just put a bit of this in each of the tanks to make sure that they get the food they need. So I've got to look after these tanks as well as the big one that you see when you walk into the science place. You see some of these fish coming in and eating some of that brine shrimp. And it's important that these guys have got plenty of food and they're looked after as well. So there's a lot of different tanks to look after in any given day, and not all of the stuff that you see in the terrariums and in the main display tank is what we've got. We've got a fair bit that you can't see, as you can see before you now. I'm going to put some food into this last one. You can see some lovely corals here that we've got, that we might be keeping for lessons, or that we might actually be making sure are healthy before we put them on display. Every now and then I go to Ames and I get corals there that they might have excess, and we can use those for research or for our display tank. So it's really good to have a facility here that we can actually keep some animals off exhibit and some corals off exhibit. It allows us to actually have a bigger capacity to absorb more of them. Actually, while I've got you here, I'll show you one of my favourite ones actually. And this is Medusa, who is actually quite famous. She's a brittle star. And I'm just going to move my hand underneath her and see if I can show you her. Look at that. I'm just going to come over this way. What an amazing animal. Look at that. It's actually called a brittle star, so it's in the starfish group. So the mouth's actually underneath it. If I hold it up like that, you can see the mouth in the center there. Really fast moving. In fact, these ones here, when you lift a rock up, sometimes they disappear so fast. You can see those legs moving along there really quickly. Really a scavenging type of sea star. So if I put food in the water, these guys will come out really quickly and take care of it. And I've heard people look at them and think, oh, they look like an octopus, but at a glance, it's because of their size. But of course, when you look at them closely, you can see they are very much a starfish. I'm gonna put this guy back and let's see where it goes.
Philadelphia go?
See how fast she moves.
I tell you what, I've got a lot of friends here in the science place and they're all shapes and sizes. From snakes to lizards to fish to starfish. Yep, no day's the same, that's for sure. And like I said before, I'm pretty lucky to have so many friends. Now, while I'm showing you around some of the behind the scenes, come with me and I'm going to show you down in the dungeons. This is where we keep all the old aquarists, all the old employees that end up underneath the building here. Not really. It's actually quite a nice place. It's nice and calm. The reason I want to take you down here, though, is because this is also a really important part of how we run the aquarium. So come down, 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 down with me. Here we go. And down here is underneath the quarantine section out the back, but it's a really important part because I've got a number of these great big 5,000 litre tanks you can see behind me. So I've got one, two, if you're following me along, three, four, and five. So these hold 5,000 litres each of salt water. This one here behind me is actually mixing between the main display tank. So what happens is if I drain water out of that tank, the pump on here, which is this fantastic pump, will actually compensate for that level and pump some water across from this tank. So that's how I do water changes in that main tank. If I run out of water in this, I can then transfer water from these other tubs behind me into that one there. So all in all, I have the five 5,000 litre tanks down here, of course holding 25,000 litres of water, salt water. Now, where do we get this salt water from? It actually comes from Ames, which is really good quality salt water. And about every month we get a delivery of about 20,000 litres, and I'll generally put about 5,000 litres a week through our display tank. Now the tank itself is about 20,000 litres, so a quarter of that water is turned over on a weekly basis. And it's from here, down underneath this dungeon area, is where we store all that critical water to do those water changes. Now, those quarantine tanks that I showed you before, just above me, they're actually fed from this one here. So that 5,000 litres in there rotates between those tanks and comes back down to that one. Now in time, that volume is reduced because of course you get evaporation and we have to top up the fresh water, and also we do water changes from time to time. So generally, that'll last a month before it's topped up, and we do that when the Ames delivery comes out. Now those quarantine tanks upstairs, above me, they actually go through this system here. They draw from this one here, they go through this pipework. They come to this amazing pump here, which is constantly working. And then what happens is they come up through this filtration here, which has what we call a bag filter in it. And then it goes up to the tanks, over the overflows, and back down into that original reservoir. So part of my job is actually changing this filter. And the way I do that, I'll try and perch this camera up while I do it. I basically have to divert the water, so basically that goes up that way, that gets turned off. Now what I've done there, I've stopped the water going through the canister. It's been diverted directly back to the tanks. And then I will open this valve here, and what happens then, that will bleed the air out. There you go. And a bit of water as well. So you can see, that's now done that. I'm gonna open this valve at the bottom, which means that all that water can come out of the canister. And now I can actually undo the top. Not too easy. You know what? I'll probably just talk you through the rest. I undo the top and I take the dirty bag out and it comes down into this tub here. There's some of the ones that have to be cleaned, and then I will put a fresh bag, here's one we prepared earlier, into that canister, and then I'll put the valves back so that water goes back through it. So a part of my job is also making sure that all the systems are clean, that they're working effectively, not only for the display tank, but also for our quarantine tanks. But this is the area that all that water is stored. So people often ask me, where do you put the water that comes out from Ames, or how do you do water changes in the tank? There, my friends, is the answer. Okay, so I think that's enough work, cleaning filters, doing all that sort of stuff, and all that hard, sweaty work. I need an animal fix. And I'm thinking the best animal fix for the moment might be something that's green and hops around. So let's have a look if you can find something that meets that brief. Yes. Who doesn't like the beautiful green tree frog? So you can see there, I've actually got a few tree frogs here. And what happens is, these guys love eating crickets. There you go, right for the camera. And what I do is I actually feed these guys a few days a week. And the best food to feed them is crickets. So we actually do keep crickets out the back. I'll see if I can come in here and show you another one having some food. Oops. And that'll eat quite a few crickets. In fact, I'll probably eat 3 or 4 crickets each on any given day. And you can see they're certainly not short on condition. Here we've got another one over here. I'm going to put some more crickets over here. And I really like frogs. I think they're an amazing animal because they're very much an indicator species. So, oh, chasing that one. You're a bit slow there, mate. Sometimes when you look around a natural environment, if you see frogs, that's a really good sign because it shows that the environment's in good condition. Because without frogs, basically, it shows that there's issues. So by having frogs around, it's a really good sign that the natural balance is there. You can see a couple more up here. So up here at JCU in the Science Place, in the terrariums, we actually have 5 beautiful green tree frogs. And it's a real pleasure to look after them because they're so iconic. Let's face it, when you go to your home and look in your gutters and your backyards, you often have these around. They're quite common in the Townsville region. And they're gorgeous little animals, full of character. As you can see, they're really good climbers. And they grow to probably about 10 centimetres long, the old green tree frog, but they're quite a big frog. They're quite robust. They're quite large in size. They're quite heavily built. And they're such a stereotypical frog. Look at that great big smile on the face. How could you not love that face? Look at that. Gorgeous. So if you are in the Science Place at JCU, please, please, please stop by and say good day to these guys because they're very, very special. And like I say, most people know frogs. And it's an opportunity that you can get nice and close to these guys and have a good look at them. But the old green tree frog, they are an absolute delight and one of my favourite animals to look after here at work. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to throw in some crickets and let these frogs help themselves. And they really rely upon movement. So when you put movement in the tank, that's what makes them look for food. So you can see they kind of, they perk up a little bit when the crickets start moving around. Here we go, bang! And they quickly engulf that that cricket. And really good little ambush hunters, actually. So I'll see if I can throw some up there and see if we can get some activity with these guys. You can see they're starting to be a bit interested. There we go, starting to look around. And I'll put that up there like that. Let's see, oops. You're gonna eat that one. I'll throw a few more up and see if we can get some action there. There we go, having a look now. Bang, oop, there we go. And as I spoke then, the misters came on. That was right on cue. So part of looking after this tank too is actually making sure that the frogs stay nice and moist because they can actually dry out quite easily. So behind me now, you can see that misting system, which actually draws water from a reservoir and mists over the frogs. And that comes on a timer, comes on about 6 times a day. So that's our frog display. So please, please, please pop by the Science Place and have a look at our frogs, because they really are, like I say, iconic of Townsville.
and so interesting. They are really lovely animals.
Hey, Hamish.
Hello, everyone. How are you?
What are you doing?
Look, I'm straight off the scooter and then straight into the water. So another part of my job is actually cleaning the tank. So I'm probably that strange guy that you've waved through the acrylic and I've waved back to you. So keep doing that because I love seeing you. But look, what I'm going to do today is actually clean the tank. So it's a bit of a tight fit. And basically, the reason I don't have a BCD on is because we need to squeeze into these tight places. So I've got this harness on. I've got my cleaning wipes here.
Yeah.
I've got my suction cap, which allows me to actually hang onto the side of the tank while I'm cleaning. And of course, I've got really good eyes on the water, but not that good. I've got my mask so that I can see. So what I'm going to do now, and I've got Yana with me, who's going to watch the dive.
How do you breathe underwater, Hamish?
Well, look, I hold my breath for a really long time. But no, seriously, what I do, I've actually got this really long regulator. So if you look down here, this is the regulator, and it's attached to our scuba cylinder. And it's this long hose that goes all the way to the surface. And basically, this goes in my mouth. It's such one I prepared earlier. And that's our breathing apparatus that I use in the tank. One of the challenges, though, is that when I'm in the tank, I've got this great big hose that comes to the surface. And that's where Yana's expert help is really needed. Because what she'll do is she'll maneuver that hose around on the surface to make sure that it doesn't get tangled up, because I've actually got to go underneath a little bridge and around the bommy. So it's not too easy to work with this. Where there's a will, there's a way, and I've got the most expert supervisor looking after me.
Yay.
So I'm in safe hands. So what I'll do, I'm going to walk along this little bridge here. I'm going to climb through that section at the end there and hop into the tank. And what I'll do, I'll be looking out for you, because once I'm in the water, please come and give me a wave and I'll say good day to you. Gives you a little bit of an idea what an aquarist does in their day. Fantastic job. Look, I tell you what, if you're a budding marine biologist, I fully recommend becoming an aquarist, because you get to do so many fun things, work with so many different types of animals. I highly recommend it. If you see me at JCU, give me a wave, say g'day. I might be in the tank or I might have a snake around my neck, but always love a chat, so come and say hi. Anyway, fast living aquarists, time to go home. I'll see you at JCU.